Okay, so we're just going to give it 30 seconds to let a few more people join before we get going. Okay, perfect. So I'd like to introduce Ginger Schmelzer, who's from the IT group, and she'll be our moderator for today, and we'll introduce the rest of the panelists.
Thanks so much, Lauren. Welcome everyone to our panel. We will be talking about how during this period of accelerated digital transformation, how do banks and merchants keep their payments secure? I'm Ginger Schmelzer. I'm a senior analyst at IT Group. We are a syndicated research firm focusing on the banking and payment space based here in the US. And what I'm gonna like to do first is just let my panelists introduce themselves. We'll just go around the room. So Matthias, we'll start with you.
Hello, thank you. So my name is Matthias and I work in Delivery Hero here in Berlin, previously working in Uruguay, where I'm from originally, in Pedidos Ya. It's a delivery company, mostly we started with food, but nowadays we deliver anything to you. And I specialize in the fintech department for the last few years.
Thank you very much. Eileen, you?
Great, thanks, Ginger. So Eileen Holcomb, I lead strategy and transformation, formerly client experience at JP Morgan in their wholesale payments business. So that includes developing and executing on our strategic vision across all of our channels from APIs and host to host and mobile and integrations, as well as our online portal. And I have been at JP Morgan for about 2.5 years. And prior to this, I was at Bank of America in a variety of product innovation and strategy roles.
Thanks. We look forward to hearing your perspective on the space. Mahmood, over to you.
Thank you, Ginger. Hi, everybody. My name's Mahmood. I am the head of product for payments at DAZN, based in London. DAZN is a sports OTT platform. So we do live and on-demand sports streaming. Earlier this year, we launched in 200 plus countries. I might have mentioned I've been with the company for 3.5 years, but before that, I worked at companies such as SagePay and Experian. So fairly familiar with payments and identity and fraud as well. So thanks for having me on this talk.
Absolutely, I'm looking forward to the discussion. So let's just kick it off. We have a lot of great things to talk about and not a lot of time to do it. So we'll dive right in. So as we said, we're talking about accelerated digital transformation, right? So during the pandemic, digital took off and accelerated it, grew it at much, much faster pace than it had been before. I've seen things talking about how we've gone, 10 years of growth in 1 year and all kinds of estimates in and around that. As that's evolved during the pandemic, though, the need to keep transactions secure has become more important than ever. And at the same time, customer experience remains really important. So Mahmood, I'll start with you. Can you talk a little bit about how your company supported a robust customer experience while still balancing that need to keep data secure?
Yeah, it's a really difficult line to walk because certainly in the past, when you ask for specific information from customers and therefore increase friction, it does give you a better chance of stopping fraud in the future because you can essentially use that data to verify people in the future in case they are trying to do any kind of account takeover or anything like that. But what I've tend to find, and I'm an advocate for this over the sort of decade plus career that I've spent in doing fraud and identity and payments. So I'm a big believer in fraud engines and in particular the ones that employ device fingerprinting, because those technologies in particular aren't too invasive on the customer experience. They're not really something that is, we're not asking for someone's date of birth. We're not asking for where they live and all these kind of things, their gender. But what's great about that technology, as I said, is that it sits in the background. It's very effective. Depending on which fraud engines you use, you'd have access to a data sharing pool of really effective intelligence about those specific devices that people use. And we've certainly seen that be very successful at DAZN. I've seen that in previous years where I would have been selling similar technology to other merchants as well. What's also interesting is that because obviously with the pandemic, more people are buying things online, it also means that the opportunity for fraud goes up. There's fraudsters want, you know, to basically get the proceeds of fraud. So if more people are shopping online, there's more potential victims. So in a way, it's also on the merchant's responsibility to protect our customers. And the last thing you want really is to be one of those companies that you see in the news that has a massive data breach. That's, you know, especially for a brand that like DAZN that's still building ourselves, that would be something we'd want to avoid like death. So certainly, you know, whatever technology you can employ to walk that line, you know, that's the best things you can do really. And as I said, it's fraud engines and device fingerprinting for us specifically.
Delicate balance though, isn't it? Right. It's you want to protect your customers and you don't want to have that data breach, but you're too secure and then they won't buy from your site, right? Or buy from your company. So it's definitely a challenge to maintain that. Matthias, have you guys had to make changes to deal with that as well?
Yeah, definitely. I completely agree that device fingerprinting is a basic tool for us, and also learning from our customers and the variety of user profiles that we have across all the countries that we manage. What can look as a fraud in one country is a normal behavior in another one. So it's very crucial for us to have people who understand the profiles and how people use our applications everywhere and adapt to it, because it's also always changing. In our case, for example, we are growing into different verticals. We started delivering food, but we also deliver groceries and electronics and etc. So the user behavior on ordering food is completely different than ordering a TV, for example. So having that into account and considering the pandemic was very important for us, because something that you don't usually order 100% online, you go to the shop, but during the pandemic, you are 100% in your house. So, and that's normal, and you have to adapt to that. So, yeah.
Yeah, and it's, you know, consumer behavior and expectations have changed because of the pandemic. But I think it's also interesting to think about that businesses have been impacted by this as well, and not just your businesses serving consumers, but Eileen, you working with businesses directly as well. So how have you seen that expectations? We as consumers have all changed our behaviors. How have you seen that kind of waterfall into the customers that you guys serve?
Yeah, sure. So wholesale solutions tend to lag behind consumer solutions overall. You know, we're always a little bit behind where the consumer side is kind of pushing the ball. But ultimately, at the end of the day, it's a user at the end of that workflow. So similar to how someone wants to order food and they want to be able to track the food and watch the delivery driver as they're driving up their street, it's the same way, you know, on the wholesale side, just on the payment side. They want to have access to that information. And so that's what we've really focused on as a bank, is thinking about the user's needs and making things a lot easier for them, but also coupled with security, right? So we're a bank, we need to make sure that the payments are secure, the way in which our clients interact with us is secure. So it's really a balancing act between how do we make it easy? So like the apps that you use, your everyday consumer experience, but also in a way that, you know, you're working for a business and they need to make sure that they have the right controls in place. So for instance, you know, if I think about our mobile app that we're updating, you know, we have security features in there in terms of login, but you know, we can leverage what consumers have in their hands right now, where they use biometrics and face ID or fingerprint to log in. We ultimately are doing the same thing. And so we're spending a lot of time working with our colleagues over on the consumer space, because they have many years of experience building those apps and saying, how can we leverage what you have over on that side for our app? So it's not this bifurcation between this is consumer only and this is wholesale only. We're really trying to come at it from a one bank perspective, which is really helpful. And I think it, you know, for us, it's really putting our perspective on, you know, what the client's needs are. We heard a lot that clients are being logged out of the system constantly, and it's just a different experience, because if your job is to be in your online banking portal system, you're constantly logging on throughout the day, and we need to make sure that you're aware if you're going to be logged out, because frankly, you know, we have to log you out for security purposes to protect you and your firm after a certain amount of time. We can't leverage that, but It's just a different user experience because you're not sitting in your consumer banking app all day long making transactions like you would be on the wholesale side. So we're really trying to figure out how we can meet the client where they are on their journey, as opposed to this is what you get, you're a business, you know, these are our three solutions, good luck. We're really focusing on what does the user need? What does the client need? How can we be there where they are?
Yeah, businesses have felt left behind for so long from the technology perspective. The consumer is always ahead. And you mentioned biometrics, and I'm curious, this came up on my panel this morning. We talked a lot about kind of face ID and fingerprint ID, things like that as ability to authenticate for consumers. And it sounds like you're starting to leverage that for some of your business customers as well. And I'm curious what all of you are seeing as far as adoption levels on that and comfort level, right? It's still, there's still privacy concerns around using my face or using my fingerprint as an ID, but it is obviously a great option for authentication. What are you guys seeing as far as that being adopted and or being rejected by customers out of concerns for security and privacy?
I can jump in here. Certainly, if you look at sort of the latest World Pay reports on payment trends and things like that, the fastest growing type of payment method is e-wallets. And in particular for Europe, where we have this thing called PSD2. I know this is for a North American audience, but might be something that'll arrive on your shores at some point. Having that frictionless flow, which has already been socialized with, you know, those specific audiences that have been using Apple Pay and Google Pay and Samsung Pay this whole time, that's not a big leap then to just continue with that user experience. So for me, I think that's a very natural thing to do. Face ID is interesting. It's a concept that's been around for a while. You'll also find identity companies that specialize in doing a facial biometric check, but then comparing it with the face that you get in an ID, like a passport or a driver's license, for example. So, you know, that's more of the sort of KYC side of things. Bringing that into the e-commerce world, yeah, there might be a little bit more of a hurdle there. But I think fingerprints feels more natural at this point. And, you know, it's not to say that as a verification or authentication tool that it's foolproof. I mean, frankly, there isn't one that is completely foolproof on its own. There's no, as I say in fraud, there's no such thing as a silver bullet. But the more things you have, the more likely you are to protect your good customers and keep the bad guys at the door. So, yeah, certainly I believe in fingerprinting for sure.
Yeah. Eileen?
I would agree. We're exploring all different types of biometrics. I mean, there's been voice that's been around for a while. So I think if at least from our perspective on the business side, if consumers have seen it and they've experienced it and they feel comfortable in their day-to-day, they're more likely to want to use that functionality. And our challenge is, how do we enable that for the business side? Because there's just different controls and different regulations. So that's our challenge. I think our users are pushing us even further. My team runs client feedback. We read every single client comment that we're getting about our digital channels. And frankly, it all comes down to, like, make it easy. Why are you making this so difficult? But it's the balance, like Mahmood said, is how do you balance that between some of the regulations that are coming out?
I love the idea of authentication by voice. And for me, I look to things like the Google Home or the Alexa. And like the more V-commerce becomes a thing, to Eileen's point, the more it becomes socialized and hopefully it'll be more acceptable as a form of authentication. But I look to those guys. Hopefully hopefully everybody wants to buy their home assistant and that's like a normal thing. And then we can progress that part.
It would make life easier. And my husband banished it from our house because he didn't want it listening in on our conversations, which I like, what are you up to that you need to, anyway. But I think it's what you were saying was interesting, that talking about fingerprints becoming kind of more normal and accepted and e-wallets driving a lot of that. And I think back to, 15, 20 years ago when touch payments, like a Pay by Touch, I think was the company's name, was trying to get fingerprints going, and people were really skeptical about it. And you know, they weren't ready for that. And when the immigration service put in fingerprinting at the airport, people were all up in arms about it. And then, you know, the phone started using fingerprints to log into your phone. Everybody was like, okay, sure, I can use that. And now it's fine. So it's interesting how the mobile devices really do kind of lead the way for people to get comfortable with security type mechanisms like that, and then opens up the opportunity for, you know, players like yourselves to integrate it into your system.
Yeah, definitely an astute observation there. Yeah.
Matthias, let me ask you about delivery services, right? Obviously, delivery services were the lifeline for many of us to eat, to get groceries, to get supplies during the pandemic. And you know, a lot of people won't go back to the way things were before, as we all know. But that had to be a challenge for you guys as a business to scale your services, to get out to more customers and to more businesses, but still to maintain the security protocols as you grew so quickly. How did you guys manage through the kind of the operational challenges of that?
Yeah, it was definitely very hard for us because at the same time, we were trying to provide to that immediate and very fast growth that we had. But at the same time, we were also working remotely and trying to adapt ourselves. Like, how do we change all our processes and all our whiteboard meetings? When we used to design everything very fast in one room discussing, it became, okay, everyone is in their room very far away. And we had many people that went back to their countries. So time zones were also becoming a problem for the one team that used to be in the same office. So I would say that apart from infrastructure and more growing in payment methods and growing in the performances of our services, I would say that the biggest challenge that we had was in human resources. So not only the people that was already working for the company on how we do we transform into a remote work company, but also how do we onboard new people remotely. And that, for example, let me give an example as a techie that I am. Whenever a programmer came and started working for us, especially in the fintech team, we had to make a really hard onboarding on security, not only for physical security and how do we keep our data secure, but also for secure coding, which is something that as a coder, not everybody has experience when they start in their career. And also in the world of payments, you have to explain what is a scheme, what is a network, what's a fraud prevention provider, what's a PSP, a gateway, blah, blah, blah. And all of that was super easy to explain again with a whiteboard and sitting in the same room. But now that more and more people are starting to work in our company and we haven't seen each other's faces, but also only in Zoom, it's hard to keep ourselves aware, let's say, of how sensitive everything, every line of code that we are doing is and how we can affect so many people around the world with what we do. And I cannot agree more with Mahmoud, about the data breach or anything security related is something that you want to avoid 100%. So yeah, the main change that we had to do was in processes and people, let's say. So how do we keep our people trained correctly and we keep being aware of what exactly we are doing and what we can face if we don't do things correctly?
And Eileen, I imagine that was a challenge you guys faced as well, trying to support your business clients who are all of a sudden remote and still had to manage payments, payroll, accounts receivable, everything else from their remote locations securely.
Oh yeah. I mean, you go back to March of 2020 and like one day you're in the office and the next day you're like, wait, no, we're not coming back, or you're on these A/B schedules. So people didn't have time to prepare. And for us, like, if we think about our digital portals, like, you know, you sit with a team, you know, you're new to a company or you have new teammates, like you can just yell over like, hey, Joe, can you help me? Like, what is the answer to this? Like, how do I create this new, you know, payment type or things like that? Like that all went away. So we were, you know, pretty concerned in the beginning because we were inundated with calls into our call center because people had a lot of questions, right? Like, you know, you have tokens, you have to sign in to your actual, you know, online banking account. You know, were you able to sign in? You didn't have your user guides next to you. You didn't have like Joe that you can ask like, hey, do you remember what to do here? So we were in exactly the same position. Okay, we're all working from home, we're all remote, you know, we had plans for different product launches last year, later into the year, but we knew clients were calling in, we knew they needed help, and they were looking for things like the status of a payment or how to do something or frequently asked questions. So we actually launched two solutions in the midst of the pandemic around like the April, May timeframe. One was a payment tracker, which was you could put in details and then it would tell you where that payment was, like, was it completed or not? And it was useful because you didn't have to log in. It didn't require login credentials because you need to know specific pieces of information about the payment to get it. But for a client or their counterparties, they can say, oh, I sent the payment. Here, use this payment tracker site and you can see where it is versus trying to call in and say, oh, the lines are busy, I can't hear anyone. And so the product manager responsible for that was going to put it out later in the year, but then said, we have such a need to just get this in the hands that we pushed up the launch by months, knowing we wanted to add different features over time. But we said the most critical thing is to make sure clients have access to information they need. And we had the same thing with the virtual assistant that was in beta for a long time, planned for the end of the year, but we rolled it out like 6 months earlier. And it was a real team effort, right? Because, you know, and I think that was a challenge of us working together. It's like, we have our service team, we have our product team, we have our marketing team, our communications team, our readiness team, and we're all on calls trying to figure out how to roll this out because we knew clients needed it. And even if it wasn't perfect, it wasn't, you know, it worked well, but there's things we wanted to add. We said, the clients need this in their hands now so they can have some sort of self-service tool that they can look up so they're not waiting on the lines to try to ask a question. So it was a whirlwind to get it done, but that was like the fastest I've ever seen anything launched in my banking career.
Yeah, I was going to say, as an ex-banker myself and remembering how long our product launches and even, you know, upgrades took, I was very impressed by how quickly some of the banks moved last year to get stuff out there. Let's talk about security a little bit more, security standards. Mahmood, we talked a bit about, you know, the digital interactions are increasing, the adherence to standards like PSDT, like you mentioned before, PCI, they become even more important to keep transactions and data secure. But you still need to streamline your own business operations around all this growth. How did you guys balance the need for adherence to the standards as well as kind of maintaining the operation levels you needed to?
Yeah, I'll take that in two parts because I think that the two different strategies we employed. So as far as PCI is concerned, I used to have a saying, it's still maybe still true, that I told my former boss, which was, if you want to be a big boy, you have to do big boy things. And back then, that would have meant having full PCI compliance, being able to handle raw card data. You know, DAZN is the company that's the last to disrupt media, in essence, sports media. You know, we've seen our contemporaries like Spotify disrupt music, and Netflix obviously disrupt movies and TV and what have you. And if you look at all those companies, they all have full PCI compliance. And we sort of came after that wave. And we had a decision to make about, you know, how important is it to have this so that we have that element of control and can do things like dynamic routing and really control over our payments versus just speed. Can we move fast and still, you know, achieve what the outcomes that we want? And in the end, we've never had to do it. We've got the lowest level of PCI compliance. We've outsourced that to all the suppliers that power our payments ecosystem. So our payment service provider, our subscriptions and billing engine, for example. And what we've found is that actually the reasons that why we would have wanted to be able to handle raw card data before have, you know, been diminished because technology's caught up. So we've seen the emergence of payment orchestration platforms that basically take that problem off your hands. They'll capture the card details for you outright using secured fields or what have you, and then they can go and send them to whatever gateways you want and basically do all the kind of things you want. Payment failover, dynamic routing, you know, if you want to do savings on FX or strategic and things like that, it's all been done. And, you know, it's still to say that you know, that there isn't necessarily no benefit to having full PCI compliance. I think there's also something to be said about fraud, for example. But what I will say is that the effort required to do that versus actually the end outcomes, it's these days, I think if you're launching now, it's not really there anymore. It's you know, you're worth just going with the minimum and, you know, using the technology out there to get what you want. as far as PSD2 is concerned, again, so we touched on this a little bit earlier, what our strategy has been is really to try and pivot away from the friction that's caused by PSD2. So for those who don't know, maybe some of you already have, interesting experiences with the use of 3D secure technology. I remember when it first launched 10 odd years ago, I was talking to merchants back then, and they were saying their basket abandonment rate had dropped to like 50%. People leaving left and right, they're like, what is this thing verified by Visa, MasterCard, secure code? And certainly, you know, with 3D Secure 2, we've not really seen an adoption of that as much as we would have liked throughout Europe. Certain countries are behind others. So we've sort of taken it into our own hands. And what we're saying is, okay, now we're going to pivot towards alternative payment methods like the e-wallets that I mentioned earlier. In this kind of another sort of angle for it, and maybe this doesn't apply to everyone, we also have sign up via living room devices and TV, and now we're slowly rolling out second screen sign up. So take away the pain of trying to do a 3D secure iframe on a TV and put it on your phone instead, where it's meant for that experience, where you can do a fingerprint biometric and then off you go. So that's really what it is. We're not going to wait for the adoption throughout for all the European banks. We're not going to wait for the technology to be super slick. We're just going to see, okay, what are the strategies we can employ right now? And then when it catches up, maybe we'll look at pivoting. But that's been our strategy basically for handling PSD2.
And just to add on to that, I mean, I think that's just the right approach. I mean, it's that age old saying, the perfect is the enemy of the good. You need to put things out there and test and learn. As a bank, like, that's not really been, you know, our strong suit. I know we're working on that more. We have wonderful like innovation and service teams that are doing that, because you want to hear what the client's saying. Because how many times have you developed something, put it out in front of the client or user, and they're like, it's not what I wanted. Right. So we're really focused on the testing and learning and trying to get feedback as we go that we can make improvements, because I don't think anyone's going to come out of like a 3-year road mapping journey with the exact perfect solution. So I love that, Mahmood, that you're not waiting for the technology, you're starting, and then we'll add as you go.
Yeah, my current manager says that all the time. Don't let perfect be the enemy of the good. So yeah,
it's a great saying. And Eileen, you've led right into my next question for you. So thank you for the tee up there. I appreciate it. But talking about the you mentioned earlier that you had to accelerate some functionality you guys had on the roadmap, but you weren't planning for it for 6 to 9 months, and you had to bring it out earlier and rethink kind of sequencing and some stuff. How has that played out kind of through the last year as you've had to rethink not just what you're offering now, but what you're going to offer on your roadmap? Have you had to change up what you're thinking of offering entirely? Have you rearranged? Have more things come to market sooner? How has that really kind of rearranged how you guys are managing your products and your I guess implementation and upgrade roadmap out to the next 12 to 24 months?
Yeah. So, well, I think we know that it's possible now versus saying before, like, oh, it'll take us a long time to really roll that out. And we're really focused on, you know, continuing to make upgrades throughout. I think one of the things that we've heard from clients is, you know, in the past we had this real, you know, waterfall methodology, and we're really focused more on trying to be more agile, right? Because I heard an example once with Amazon. You know, the background of Amazon used to be gray, and then eventually it became white, but no one noticed because it happened in just small increments. It didn't happen in a big bang sort of change. And I think that's one of the focus areas for us here at the bank is, rather than wrapping like a ton of features at the end of the year, and then the client's like, what did you do? And what are all these new things? We're really trying to, how do we make incremental changes and really have this multi-year roadmap to say, if we want to have, you know, our UX and UI capabilities be driven by what type of industry the client is, what size the client is for our online platform, we need to make incremental changes throughout. So we're really focused on where do we want to be in, you know, 2025 plus, and saying, okay, then backing into that, what are the steps we need to get there? One of the things that we've really pivoted on, to your point, Ginger, is like, self-service, right? That was never in banking and wholesale. It's always like a lot of handholding and relationship management. But with the pandemic, we've seen like self-service is a really big functionality, right? Like the virtual assistant or chatbot that we have, this payment tracker, they're all self-service functionalities. So we have a team that's really looking at how do we, you know, make self-service more attractive to our clients? Because, you know, frankly, I don't want to sit on a call and have to call someone to walk me through something. I want to be able to figure out how to do it. So we've been doing a ton of research, a ton of usability testing with clients, which we did previously, but even more so now, to kind of get their thoughts and really co-create and co-develop with them. So I would say between focusing on self-service, that we don't have to deliver everything to you by hand. You can do things on your own, and really finding out what that means and what the client wants through new research and development programs, and really putting that sort of design thinking lens into everything that we're doing. It just has been, we started it, but it's been accelerated by the pandemic, because we're hearing our clients so much more. They're very vocal around what they like and don't like.
For sure. And moving to more self-service as well, I imagine has kind of reinforced that need for authentication and verification, the security piece of it as well. Because when they did a full service, you knew you were talking to your client rep, and they could authenticate who you were, you know, just because they knew you to a certain extent. And I imagine that the rigor you had to put around authenticating and logins and everything else for the self-service has been a lot of work as well.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's really just, you know, we also are trying to think of things outside of the traditional, you know, banking portal, banking platform, and thinking around APIs is a really big, you know, channel for us as well. Is what does that look like? And what do those solutions look like? And how do we integrate and how do we implement really quickly for our clients, but in a safe and secure way? Because, you know, our clients use different ERP or TMS systems. We need to meet them in terms of what they're using. So we have like logins into our system, but then how do we make sure the security is also passed when they're using our data in their own systems?
Yeah, it's the complexity just kind of mounts up as you keep looking at it. And thinking of complexity, like Matthias, one of the things I'm interested in from your perspective, you guys work across 50 countries on 4 continents, right? And the complexity that creates for payments and then for security, it's got to be a bit mind-boggling. How do you guys manage through that to keep, you know, your local customers within whatever payment choice they want to make, but still keeping everything secure for them and for you?
Well, it's a really good question. So yeah, I think that the security, starting from that point, is not only in payments, it's in the whole application, in the whole experience of the user, right from where they start. So when they log in, for example, and register, we already have some data about them and how we are going to keep their account secure from the very beginning. Because as we were talking before, many apps are becoming also wallets, and that's including ours. So you can have, like a referral bonus or something that you collect some balance in our app. So from the very beginning of the user lifecycle, it's very critical that we keep your security as a first priority. So we try to work with you to verify your device, your email, your account, etc., and keep that money secure. And I started with that because a few years before, you weren't so concerned about how secure your account was in a delivery site. But now that you have your credit cards, your Google Pay, Apple Pay, PayPal, some balance, etc., into your account, if someone steals your phone or steals your account, they have access to many things. And that became really sensitive in the last few years, and that made us work very closely with other teams, not only fintech in the company, but also the consumer facing teams and the mobile application developers are super experts in how we keep the security of the users in every point of their life cycle. But also taking that into the extension of which countries and which regions we are, the possibilities for us are different in every country. So for example, there are some countries that we have very good tools for fraud prevention and device fingerprinting, but in some countries, they are not there, or it's more difficult to get the data of the users, or there is restrictions according to the laws of the country are different. So it's very, very hard to get a generic solution for the entire planet. But at the same time, you do want to have the data in the most generic way internally, let's say. So, and again, here I'm speaking about code. The more generic that you can make your code, and then only make it specific when needed, the best that you can work. Because if you have completely different solutions for every country, you go crazy. And you, if you have only one solution for all the countries, you also go crazy. So finding that balance is a very thin line that can help you survive. And I would say that one of the things that made us very successful in the countries that we are is that we kept local teams everywhere we are. We have people that are from the country working for us and telling us to the lowest detail possible how we can make the app feel local for the person there. I don't know, if in Uruguay you ask me for something like Klarna that is only Europe specific, you're only confusing me. Like, what is this payment method? Don't even show it to me. So it's like, try to work with your local team so that you can understand your users and understand the technologies that are available in that country. And also coming back again to fraud, understand the fraudster profile in that country. And those are like key things that make us successful in being in so many countries at the same time.
Yeah, Matthias, a question just came in from one of our attendees, which is very much around what we were just talking about. Like, how have you scaled the growth during the pandemic while keeping your product secure for your growing consumer base? And you shared some good examples of that. And Mahmoud, are you guys multi-country as well?
Yeah, we're in 200 countries. We launched.
There you go.
Yeah.
So how are you guys managing that?
No, I echo everything Matthias said. So for us, certainly one of the things that I really pushed for in this sort of 2 years of work that it took to go live was wherever we could have local currency and local prices, because that has such a big impact on customer comfort, especially again, when you're a brand that has zero presence in that country. You know, we're not Disney, we're not Coca-Cola, you know, but if people see something they trust, i.e. you know, a price and currency they recognize and payment methods that they recognize, then they'll be like, okay, I think I can probably take a punt on this and see how it goes. So yeah, that's exactly what we did, and we found that has worked to great effect. Our content's very boxing led, so that means it's kind of sporadic in terms of events, but typically when we have a fighter from a specific country, we always get a spike there, and that's might have been the country we weren't in previously, and I like to think part of it was to do with our payments proposition in those markets.
And you talked earlier about kind of outsourcing a lot of your security standard work to ensure that you had kind of the best in class solutions. And so as you've grown to all those markets and your consumer base is growing as well, certainly the standards vary by region, by market, et cetera. And so are you really relying on your partners to help you stay compliant and secure? Or do you find that you have to internally bring some of that stuff in-house as well as you grow?
I think, to be honest, for now, I think we're good outsourcing it. It's in our partners' interest as well as ours that they keep on top of their standards, because if there's no us, there's no them. So to that extent, you know, but that doesn't mean that we don't have a security team in-house, because we absolutely do. And, you know, they're there to make sure that we are maintaining the standards properly, protecting ourselves from things like brute force attacks and what have you, and also obviously to carry out audits and what have you. But so far so good, we've not had any problems. And I think in terms of growing globally speaking, I don't envisage any hurdles. I think there are certain annoyances about specific markets where, for example, customers expect invoices in certain Middle Eastern countries So that's like a new piece of functionality that we wouldn't have to have considered for the 9 markets that we were in last year versus the 200 that we're in this year. So there's little bits here and there. You know, again, we can talk about sort of Argentina as well, and whether you go for an Argentinian peso, whether you charge in US dollar, and whether certain payment methods will support you in that country or not. You know, PayPal in particular comes to mind. So there's challenges there, but that's not within our, it's within our grasp to fix it, basically. We can still deal with all those in a manageable way, in a timely way.
Matthias, how about you guys? Are you outsourcing some of the compliance work as well, or do you do much of that in-house?
I completely agree with what Mahmoud was saying about choosing the right providers in specific regions. So again, I see this as a complex balance of how much you outsource and how much you put all your eggs in the same basket, let's say. So there's definitely some things that you want to outsource. For example, the vaulting of credit cards, you don't want to have your, or at least not for every company it makes sense, but for most of the companies, it doesn't make sense to store raw credit card data and have the highest PCI compliance level. So choosing that kind of provider that gives you that is a really good choice. But also, to give an example of the other extreme, let's say, don't choose only one provider and trust the payment methods that provider gives you, because your hands are tied there. So if they have an opinionated API or something very rigid, and the relationship with that provider is not very dynamic. For example, it happened to us that we were using only one provider for allowing payments in one country, and all of the banks in that country started requiring a certain field to be passed to them. And because we were not talking to the banks directly, but through this provider, we were completely hand-tied there until the provider added this field. So yeah, the balance between how much you outsource and how much you do in-house is hard to find. My advice should be to find the provider that fits you better and to, that has the same interests than you. If you're growing together with your provider, that means that their timeline is going to be tied with yours, and you are going to be partners and not client customer, let's say.
And Eileen, how do you guys manage that for your clients? How much of security and compliance are you guys managing on their behalf, and how much are you helping them to support that in other markets where they might operate?
Yeah, so regulation and compliance is the name of the game here in banking. So, you know, we really have great compliance teams that are part of the bank here. And then we work with like local regulators to really understand what functionalities that we can provide in country, and you know where we need to differ. I mean, from a investment management perspective, because my team does manage that, I mean, it is like a regulatory sort of hurdle around different payment types in different countries for different users. And you know, one thing comes up in one country you didn't plan for, and then how do you manage that sort of thing? So that's really the name of the game, is really understanding those regulations and working very closely with our in-country partners. I think that's the benefit of having a lot of my partners and peers that sit in country, right? They know the regulators, they know what's coming down the pipeline, they know the compliance, they know their clients, and they can talk to them around, you know, what are the different pay types or payment methods and functionalities that they need.
Yeah, it's really fascinating how much how much of the business remains local, even given the global scale of all of your businesses and certainly your customers' businesses as well. The hyper-local approach still is important for meeting the needs of local consumers and the local businesses and, you know, Matthias, to your drivers, that kind of thing. Is there's just a lot of the dynamics there that you know, persist regardless of how much we can scale the business outside of that. Let's have a little fun to wrap things up. So if you were going to pull out your crystal ball, right, there's a lot that's changed in the last year, and most of us wouldn't have predicted it. 14 months ago, we wouldn't have thought we would, like, what, 16 months ago, maybe, let's say, we wouldn't have predicted we'd be where we are right now from a payments or life perspective in general, but let's just stick to payments. So pulling out your crystal ball, and if we're looking out to 2025, right, and given what we've done in the last, you know, year and a half, what do you guys see payments looking like, and for consumers and businesses, you know, from your point of view, what does it look like in 2025? Mahmood, I'll start with you.
Yeah, it's a great question. Right now, I'm not convinced by open banking or crypto yet. Obviously with the recent sort of things that have happened in the crypto world, that's kind of proved my point. Open banking, absolutely on board with the idea of it and weaponizing it as a payment method, and obviously the costs implications, or the cost savings I should say, and the security standpoint, you know, all makes sense, but people just have to use it, people have to like it. So that's kind of the thing that I'm I don't think we're there yet, and I'm not sure we'll be there in 5 years. What I do think will happen is that I think we'll become more of a cashless society. So I'll tell you a little story. So yesterday I went to the mall with my kids, and there was, you get these like kiddie rides in the mall, these small sort of cars, and they move. And I put my son in it, and I went to put some coins in, and I realized it doesn't take coins, it takes Google Pay. I was like, oh, okay. So that shook me. And then when I went to go pay for my car parking, no coins either. I also had to pay by Google Pay or contactless. So I mean, there you go. That's me.
It's funny because you go the opposite direction. I went hiking this weekend, and I went to, they had a vending machine at the restroom stop. And I went to use my phone to buy a bottle of water, and it only took coins and bills. And I was like, what? How does this happen anymore in the 21st century? So yeah, it does swing both ways on that, but it is interesting when you run into it. Matthias, how about you? Crystal ball, what do you think?
I would say that something really nice happened in Germany during the pandemic. So for this, I need to go back a little. When I was coming from LATAM to Europe, I thought I was coming to the most advanced payments society, and everything was going to be paid by, yeah, Google Pay or Apple Pay or by your smartwatch or whatever. But it turned out to me that, with a huge surprise, that Germany's cash oriented still. It was until 2020. And what happened during the pandemic is that the consumers forced the restaurants and groceries and etc. to have contactless payments everywhere, because we don't want to be managing money and touching the bills that you don't know where they have been, right? Mm-hmm. So you are like with your phone and trying to say like, can I pay from here and keeping my distance? And if you went to a restaurant or something that they didn't have that payment option, you didn't go anymore. And you said, okay, yeah, nice food, but no, thank you. I will go to the other one that has the payment options that I want. So I see that happening in the future more and more, and in other scenarios. I mean, online it has been happening for long, but I see customers with much more power nowadays. A few years ago, the merchant was the one that said you can pay with this and this and this, but nowadays I see, and more in the future, I see the user saying, I want order if you don't have this payment method, that is the one that I want. And also with the wallet being more and more popular every day, and for this I look always to Asia, which I think that it's in technology and how the payments culture is, I think that's the way that we are all going. You want to pay with the wallet that you have balance with, right? So if I'm accumulating money because, I don't know, some friends sent me money in my PayPal account, I want to be able to use my balance in the merchant that I'm paying. So I see customers with much more power saying, this is how I want to pay. And merchants suffering if they don't have that payment option.
Interesting, the shift of power.
Yeah.
Eileen, how about you?
One, will checks finally be dead, at least in the US, because people are not in person and they don't want to touch any paper. Mm-hmm. So maybe that will happen. I know that's been the thought for, I don't know, 10 plus years now, but they continue taking relevance. I think from the business perspective, I think it'll continue to be customization, right? In the past, at least on wholesale side, you got what you got. Here it is. Here's your portal. Here's what you have. Good luck. This is what we offer. And I think we're continuing to move towards more customization and really being integrated into our clients' ecosystem and whatever technology they're using. Similar to what you see on the consumer side is you can pay, you know, natively in any sort, practically any app that you have, even like looking at Pinterest boards, you can pay or buy something. Mm-hmm. Like all of that is really shown on the consumer side. I'm hoping that it continues to show on the wholesale side to make it easier for people to really do their jobs and taking out some of those manual steps and driving more adoption of AI technologies, which we've talked about for a long time, but how do we really leverage those to make it easier to still the age old question, I got paid. I don't know what I got paid for. I got paid for something. And like, let me try to figure out what this is related to. And we'll continue to drive towards that and maybe solve it so that we can really be, you know, cutting edge on the wholesale side.
Interesting. It's fascinating to think about how it's all getting evolved. My last panel talked about how the people will start looking more for the experience. So things like a grocery store, right? The things are in the center of the store, you'll just order those online. They're commodities, but for the produce and the meat and things, I want to go in store and I want to be a part of that. And I want to do that purchasing and that paying myself. And it's interesting how our priorities, I guess, have been evolving over time. And I think that the consumers are demanding kind of that shift, to your point, the power is shifting really to the consumers. And so something like grocery shopping, which we haven't rethought for 50 years, is now becoming a very different experience. And that same is true for so many parts of our lives. And certainly on the business side as well, the way business has been, payments have been transacted for decades is going away. And so we recorded the session. So in 2025, we'll all circle back up and see who was right and who wasn't. So I really appreciate you guys taking the time today. This has been a great discussion. I know I've enjoyed it. I hope that you guys have too, as well as our audience. We're going to sign off and let everybody go on to their next session. So thank you to my panelists and thank you to the conference organizers. Everyone have a great day.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Bye.